Hey everybody, welcome to the LitRPG podcast. I am Ramon Mejia, and you already got a sneak peek at my guest because I forgot to have the camera on him first. With me today is the author of one of the first LitRPG dungeon series on Amazon, The Slime Dungeon Chronicles. It's been called a truly inspired work, a pure genius, and a great piece of LitRPG by its readers. Welcome the man, the myth, the legend, Jeffrey Falcon Logue, or Falcon to his friends.
Hello.
So there he is, everybody. Jeffrey Falcon Logue, or Falcon to everybody. Thank you a lot, man, for coming on the show and talking about your series, your LitRPG series, The Slime Dungeon Chronicles. I've read your first two books. Big fan. I guess you're the first person to publish a dungeon story on Amazon, as far as I'm aware, in our genre. I've seen some other things that are similar on like Royal Road and some of the places, but hey, you have the distinction of being the first on Amazon, man. So congrats.
Thank you.
Okay. So we'll begin our interview with the same basic question we ask every author. For people who are not familiar with you or your works, my friend, can you tell me a little bit about yourself and your background?
Okay. My name is Jeffrey Falcon Logue. I got the nickname Falcon back in high school. That's one of those band stories I'm not going to go into, but I am a student going to Clemson University. We are in the midst of celebrations, as some of you guys may know. I recently switched to a English major from a genetics major. So I am pretty well versed in biology, and I've decided my passion in life is writing, so I've switched to that to help improve that.
Awesome, man. That's a really big switch, though. I would imagine it's to a new slew of prerequisites and classes, and not everything would transfer over to your new major, man. So that's a really big leap as far as like a devotion of time. So yeah, good, but for you.
You know, you got to do what you find happiness in and what motivates you. You can make a lot of money with something, but if you're unhappy, then you're gonna have a short life.
I absolutely agree that pursuing the things you're passionate about not only are better for you, your mental health and your physical health, but they're also just better for everyone else, because your product is going to be much better when it's something you care about as opposed to something you just kind of do. So I think it's a great choice, and I definitely hope the new major works out for you.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much for the background information. That's honestly the most succinct background story anyone has ever given me on any of these interviews. And that's like, oh, that's pretty cool. Okay. So next question then. Writing, you're a writer. You write in the genre called LitRPG. Your first book is called The Slime Dungeon Chronicles. Can you tell me a little bit about like a brief summary for people who don't know what the story is about? How would you give them your elevator pitch for your story?
For Slime Dungeon. Okay, for Slime Dungeon, that was a story I wrote back in November of 2015. At the time, it was written because the dungeon genre was starting to get a little popular on Royal Road. My story, which actually came about as a result of another story I wrote, the ending was about a person who got turned into a dungeon mind. So with this one, I said, you know, I want to make a dungeon story, my own dungeon story. So then I thought, what monster do I want to put in there? All the other dungeon stories have like ecosystems. So I said, I want one monster. I only have to worry about one thing. And I chose slimes because nobody ever talks about slimes.
Yeah.
So the basic summary of the story is a person in our world passes away. And by the wonders of magical fantasy reincarnation, his soul ends up in another world and is placed inside of a crystal that is turning into a dungeon core. So from then, he has to grow and become a dungeon. And he does this by working with his new partner, a dungeon pixie named Claire. Together, they work together to create the best dungeon they can, to eat as many people as they can, and have fun about it all the way.
Yeah, it's a wonderful story, and I think most unique things about it, for I highly doubt that anybody who's not already in the LitRPG or into like rare world stories has ever heard of this kind of story at all. On the rare world, you said it, I agree, is becoming more popular on the rare world or Wattpad and online stories. I think the very first couple came from other countries like Japan or Russia. But a lot of those stories are themed around, like you said, biomes, you know, hive minds, things like that. They take a very alien approach to the dungeon mindset. Like it's an alien species in a lot of different ways. And your approach of putting your human mind in there makes it a lot more relatable. And I loved, the thing that drew me into your story the first time was, it's a slime. I'm like, that's the weakest monster in most RPGs or JRPGs. And you made it the core badass monster of the dungeon. And I loved that humorous aspect of it, which is what drew me personally to picking up your book and paying hard cash to read it on Amazon. So
Hold on. Yeah. It's not that expensive. Don't throw that at me.
No. But people really pay money for it. So something draws them to it, right? Some aspect made them say, I'm going to part with my hard-earned money. And for me, that's what it was. It was that it was unique, that it was special. And like, oh, this is cool and interesting, and I'm willing to go the whole way through it. So that's, to me, that's something that can draw in other audience members, that it's a very unique story, and I think it's kind of cool.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, man. So that's a really good summary. I appreciate that. Let's talk a little bit about some of your characters in your story then. I'd say there are two main characters. Mm-hmm. The slime dungeon itself, Doc. Right. And the pixie then, Claire. And I actually have to say, comment real quick. I think I have the same intro you do. Like my character for Adventures of Terra, he's reincarnated and he has a fairy guide. Name is Mary. But I'm like, okay, that's the extent of our similarities. I think a lot of like LitRPG authors choose that kind of theme because it's an easy way to introduce in the world. Yeah. So I just have to say, me and you, man, same intro. Good job.
I will expect royalty costs later.
I hope you're kidding.
I am.
Okay. I know. Okay. So tell me about your character, Doc and Claire. They're the main characters of your story, I would say. What makes them special?
Well, they're both special. Doc is more special than Claire. Doc is a species of monster known as a dungeon. Mm-hmm. As a dungeon, his original body is that of a crystal that has the ability to manipulate mana. If you can imagine a bit of evolution, you have I've talked about these in my story, a mana stone, which has an element of some sort, fire stone, dark stone, etc. Eventually, there's a mutation because all sorts of things happen underground, and what happens underground stays underground. And it gains the ability to manipulate that mana around it. Eventually, it starts to absorb. And eventually, it starts to gain primitive instincts. From those instincts, it will gain tendencies. And with those tendencies, it will gain the ability to choose a better course of action over the other. And that leads it to evolving sentience. And I use the word evolve rather than adapt because really it is evolving. It's turning from an inanimate object into a living thing. And as you can imagine, due to this process, most dungeons are extremely selfish. They do everything in their power to make themselves grow. They barely consider any other people or any... They eat everybody. They're very omnivorous that way.
Absolutely. Let me make a real quick point of clarification for people who don't know what kind of dungeon you're talking about. This is not the kind of dungeon where there are whips and chains and people get all kinky. This is the kind of dungeon where, in fantasy stories, where adventurers generally go into to find treasures and monsters and loot. And in this case, your story is told from the perspective, or at least partway through, from the perspective of that dungeon. And I really like the fact that and it kind of makes sense to me now, that your evolutionary pathway for your dungeon makes real biological sense, even if it's fantasized a little bit. And, you know, there are big spurts of growth, and real evolution doesn't take days or months or years, you know, millions of years, whatever. In this case, it still has that same understandable, realistic sense of progression. Right. And it makes sense because of your background in evolutionary science.
Right. Genetics, that kind of thing. Well, the back to that, Doc is unique because rather than start from the beginning, he has a soul. Dungeons don't really get souls most of the time. Souls are granted by the gods in this world. If it does form, then it's a very unique process, and there's normally some sign of revelation, right? A big light in the sky, like, oh my gosh, a miracle has occurred. Somebody made their own soul. And that might be a thing in later books, hint, hint. But Doc, his soul was placed in a core. Now, as familiar with the reincarnation genre, as most people are, then, and your story doesn't have that too much in it, but most souls, when they reincarnate, lose their memories. Doc loses his memories, though in the very beginning of the book, he has some of them before they disappear. You can tell in the rest of the story, he no longer remembers his past life. But his soul still has all that all that experience again from his previous life, which is why he can learn things quickly. He's able to adapt like a person rather than a baby. But he has no experience, so right. He doesn't know things. He's very childish in that regard. So in the first book, he's a newborn. In the second book, he's still learning. In this third book, he's going to have gained some maturity. We're going to talk about that later. Claire is also unique. Claire is a race that I created. This is my race, Dungeon Pixie. It's a species of pixie that have evolved to coexist with dungeons. This happened some point in the past. Some pixie fled and a cunning dungeon made a pact with it, binding it like a symbiotic, mutualistic relationship. They can't hurt the other, and they help the other. Now, when that pixie had children, they inherited the pact. Not with the original dungeon, but to choose their own dungeon. And also, as a result, their species changed over time to become what's today an underground pixie.
Right.
I will get around in future books, but I've mentioned that Claire wouldn't live very long if she left Doc for a long period of time. That's because the sun would eventually kill her, actually. She needs his magic to stay alive if she leaves the dungeon.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, those are great answers. I like the influence of evolutionary adaptation, changing monster species qualities over time because of some, you know, in this case, a magical event. An evolution. And it has a nice sense of realism and a kind of twist to other kinds of these fortifications. And you are correct. My reincarnation is only reincarnation in the loosest sense in the word. I might as well have said he was magically teleported, and that would have been just as accurate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we have a little bit of information about your main characters, Doc and Claire. And you've given us a little bit of insight into the behind the scenes process of your thinking of how Doc changes and evolves and creates. He gathers energy from the things that they eat or the creatures that they kill.
Right.
And of course, the more complicated those creatures are, the more energy he gets and the more he can do within his dungeon as that source of energy and fuel. And of course, as he devours, he grows like any creature.
Right. I am going to correct you on that. Energy is more something Dakota uses.
Yes.
I rely on mana. The different systems is sort of going to play out in a soon-to-be adventure.
Okay, and you're mentioning Dakota Kraut. He's the other author who's writing a dungeon story on Amazon. His is called the Divine Dungeon series. Yep. I have his book right in here, but you two are not in competition. I believe you guys are buddies, right?
We're buddies, but his reviews exceeded mine, so I have a bit of competition with him now for pride.
Hey, that's a perfectly fine thing to do. Competitiveness seems like the American pastime, so it's perfectly acceptable to have friendly competition. But you want to for the folks that have asked before, these guys like each other. They're not haters. Our community is very very welcoming and congratulatory of other authors. Even if they write similar-ish stories.
He has told me that my story did help him write his, which I can appreciate, and I want to help other authors do the same thing.
Yeah, absolutely. We're all inspired by somebody. I know I am. I myself, and I at the beginning of my story, I took ideas from everybody, any kind of LitRPG that I loved. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to use this one and this one and this one. And eventually it became its own thing as the story progresses. But very much in the beginning for me, as a writer, as a first-time writer especially, I was like, I have no idea what I'm doing, but this is where I'm going to start. And we all start somewhere, and we're often inspired by the things that we love. So mm-hmm. I think it's a compliment. Okay, so next question is, what are you working on now? You have book one and you have book two out. Mm-hmm. You're working on book three, I hope?
I am working on book three. I'm halfway done through book three in both writing and editing. I'm doing both at the same time now. It's coming along well. I've reached the halfway point in book, and you've seen in the past books, once the halfway point gets hit, I start building up to that final battle.
Okay,
and,
perfect.
And this, the nice thing, though, and this is a bit of a spoiler, book three is going to end on a bit of a cliffhanger. not a severe cliffhanger, not like throw the torches at me, but enough to like to be continued.
Okay. Is there someone hanging off an actual cliff?
There are no cliffs on the plains.
Okay, good. Because I mean, that was a huge criticism of Valor and Kong's last book, or a couple books ago, where he literally had somebody as a cliffhanger, hanging somebody off of a cliff. I'm like, I just have to ask, just to clarify, since he wrote that, it's a question I have to ask.
I know. That is, why would you do that to your audience?
I think that's what every audience member asks whenever they get a cliffhanger. It's like, you are a cool author, my friend. Give me the next book and I'll forgive you.
Yep. So that's what I'm currently working on. And I'm working on getting an Audible version of book one done. I have somebody I like. He's agreed to start working on it. It should take about a month and then a couple of weeks of processing. So that's in the process. I have no control over that now.
Perfect. So we'll ask the big question right off the bat. When can we expect book three to hit the shelves?
I expect to have book three completely written by the end of January. And if the editing process keeps working as swiftly as it's been, probably about the same time done. So mid-February, generous. Maybe the end of the second week.
Okay, so we'll say tentatively a February release date, just so people don't get up in arms if you happen to miss the mid part of that. We'll say
tentatively. That happened last time.
Yeah, which is why we'll give a much bigger window. February release date tentatively, and from what you told me about the Audible release schedule, it looks like end of February, beginning of March release date, depending on how fast Audible, processes their file stuff.
Yep.
And that's going to be an Audible for just book one, right?
Just book one. And I've never used Audible. If it works out, then I'll have them do book two, too, and book three, et cetera, et cetera.
No, I hear you. Hey, you're not going to invest in your whole series if the first one tanks. So this is going to be your test market, your test one. And if it does well, then I'm sure you'll translate everything else into Audible as well. So if you're an Audible listener, if you listen to audiobooks, this is good news. So good for you guys. Okay. So let's talk a little bit more about just a little bit more information about your story, because you have two and you have a third on the way. And we've kind of talked about a little bit about the very beginning almost of just book one, the dungeon perspective, how the dungeon grows and changes. Now, we haven't really talked about its connection to adventurers, though. How does the dungeon change so that it entices adventure? Because that's essentially the connection between traditional fantasy and this particular type of fiction, is that in traditional fantasy, we get the adventurous perspective of delving into a dungeon crawling, fighting monsters, evading traps, getting the loot, getting experience points. And in this particular case, especially in book one, more so, you get the dungeon perspective of okay, how do I become a successful dungeon? How do I get adventurers to come in? How do I make monsters or entrap monsters? And how do I create loot and all that good stuff? So how do you, in your writing, connect those two ideas?
The main reason, the connection, comes from Claire. Unlike traditional stories and the other stories that I read before I wrote this, Claire is a source of progress. Her line of dungeon pixies have all the experience and strategies to see, okay, if we work in this way, this attracts more people. Oh, if we work in this way, we all get killed. So it's sort of like she's almost like a cheat book in the ways of doing a dungeon.
Yeah. And not only I was gonna say a guidebook, a player guidebook, but not a cheat book, but yeah. Like a player guidebook. Yeah. I agree.
I'm from that generation. We called them cheat books.
I know. I am too. Yeah.
So even though she's young, her real age is pretty old, but in terms of being a pixie, she's about 14 years old in human terms. So she's going to make some mistakes and all that, but she, as her memory holds, is really important to Doc. Mm-hmm. She knows what he needs to do to be successful and what to do to make the most efficient growth with the least amount of danger involved.
Right, because, so she becomes his expert dungeon-making guide, right. Telling him what traps are the best to you without making it too challenging for the adventurers.
Right.
And he's essentially also how to change over time as his dungeon becomes more popular and you get more powerful adventurers. Mm-hmm. He's like, oh, no, you're not getting a whole other level with these different set of traps so that they're enticed in and they're kind of challenged at the same point. And so it very much becomes almost like a creation video game. If people have ever played the Dungeon Maker games, this is what you do. You create different levels of dungeons and adventurers come through and they fight and they die, and that's the balancing challenge between not making it too hard and getting your dungeon killed, and but not making it too easy either, where they can just swipe out your loot and they never die, because that's how the dungeon gets its mana and its source of experience to grow and to change.
Right.
Okay, so that's your dungeon part. Now tell me a little bit about, because like with any good resource in a realistic setting, people are going to want to farm that resource. So a town appears around the dungeon in the first book, mm-hmm. and it becomes a major part of book two as well. Can you tell me about that dungeon town?
Okay. So this is something that made people upset, as you can see in the reviews for book two. But book two was more focused on the dungeon town, hence the name, the dungeon town.
The dungeon town, yes. The name is kind of a spoiler.
Yeah. This physical copy, which was recently done. Mm-hmm. You can see some of the background in the main adventurer character of this book there. The reason why the dungeon town becomes important is that it provides a source of adventurers to Doc. It's sort of like he found a spring of water, but instead of water, it's meat.
It's meat bags, adventurers. Yes.
Now, in this world, well, in all worlds, everybody knows slimes have a slime core. I'm not sure about in the Dragon Quest universe, but I specifically did my best to avoid any Dragon Quest reference. I hate slime with eyeballs.
Seem so weird, and I'm like, they kind of creep me out, I'll admit.
I think they're adorable, but they aren't what real slimes are. The same way I don't believe in female armor revealing most of their skin. That makes no sense. So slime cores are very important for potions. It's basically a lower form of a mana stone. You smash it up, you add it to a potion, you can create healing potions, mana potions, stamina potions. You don't see that too much in the first two books. I'm going to introduce more on the whole enterprise in the third book. But he goes, of course, Doc evolves beyond just slime cores, right? Mm-hmm. Like his bug slimes will drop pieces of chitin or a red beetle husk that can be turned into paint. He gets Claire brings him some herbs and plants that can be mined is not the right word, gathered from his dungeon. So the alchemists and the potion makers want to get in the dungeon, so they hire adventurers to take him down to the right floor. So that becomes that process, hires them to protect them. So adventurers now, they can hunt in the dungeon, they can protect the miners, that's also in book two, they can help out around the town, and they can do guard duty. So all this is provided by Doc. If he was not there, this whole town would become a ghost town. He's the backbone of the town. And in the first book when I wrote it, people complained I didn't focus on world building. So I focused on world building in the second book, and people complained I did too much world building.
I'll say my review said that I'm one of those people like, he spent a little too much time outside the dungeon. So I'll freely admit that I kind of fall into that crowd. I liked your story. But to me, the book one that made it super special was the dungeon part. So right. I hear what they're saying, but I also see your point of view as an author. You're like, I did what you said. Why are you mad at me again?
It had to happen.
Yeah, it absolutely did.
the third book that I'm writing will be mostly doc, but there still are going to be important things happening in the dungeon town.
Good. Good. I'm absolutely glad to hear that you're returning more of a focus to the dungeon, because I think that to me that there's plenty of stories about towns, in my opinion, but right. There aren't as many stories about dungeons, and I think that's where you have a special opportunity to tell a very unique story. And I think that's the core of what people loved a lot about book one, and that's what made it special to me. But that's my opinion as a reader, more of an author. I do like your description of the town. If I can make an analogy, that might sum it up a little bit better. In the same way that in the Western United States, when there was a gold rush, towns sprang up out of nowhere around the mining community and mines in, you know, gold mining. Towns that sprang up, resources would be gathered, and once those resources were spent, that town disappeared. They became ghost town. And very much the same way, your dungeon and dungeons in this world are valuable resources for the exact reason that you spoke about. They provide alchemical materials, you know, potions, magic, armor. All those things are found in nature naturally, of course. But as an abundantly renewable resource, dungeons are it. In this world, dungeons are solid gold. As long as they're not too hard and they're not killing too many people, they're a wonderful source of renewable wealth for an entire community. And so that's what happens here. A few people start traders, and then those traders start creating things. Crafters come, and of course, with crafters, you have money exchanges, so bankers, and an entire boom town springs up around this dungeon, a dungeon town. And of course, as the dungeon grows, you know, it gets harder and more valuable material, so does the town. And so those two things are a very symbiotic relationship, which is why it makes sense you would talk about both of them, because they're both important story elements, and they're both opportunities to tell very different stories. And I like that about that. I think that's a really interesting part of your story as well.
Mm-hmm. To make it similar, in this world, there are labyrinth towns. And and for the readers out there who aren't too familiar with the term dungeon, it's also another name is a labyrinth, an underground.
Now, are labyrinths in your story different than dungeons?
Not particularly.
Okay.
The dungeon name came around because of the idea of an underground part of the castle, a lot of dead things down there. A traditional dungeon where you store criminals. But the original name is a magic labyrinth. The floors change and everything. And that name is stuck with the traditional towns in like major rich cities.
Right.
But in like the boonies, which is sort of where Doc is, they're called dungeons.
Oh, poor Doc. He's a boonie labyrinth.
I mean, his country, Nehatra, is not a united country. They're each individual city-states, sort of like Athens and Greek in Greece. And actually, I made the name Nehatra by taking the name Athens and the name Sparta, reversing them, putting them together, and taking off a few consonants.
That's how you come up with your names. Sometimes I've used random name generators for my character names because I can't think of anything, or I'll use like Latin or Greek or Spanish or whatever, just translations or regular words. So whatever it takes, man.
Yep. So they're a collection of city states. They're in constant competition with each other. There's no free goodwill that a normal united country would have. Kind of like the European Union, but less rich.
Okay, that's a nice that bit of world building knowledge right there. I think that's beautiful. It's succinct, but it adds depth to the world as a whole without like being its own story necessarily. I think that's a good bit of information. I would just drop that in your story if you haven't already. But let's see. Next question, though, we're going to switch a little bit from your true stories a little bit into your genre. You write in a genre. Do you consider yourself a LitRPG author? I should ask first.
That is a very tricky question.
Oh.
In the original LitRPGs, no, I was not considered that, but I was still invited to the Facebook page by Alaron. Recently, he amended the rules in the midst of a rather interesting Facebook debate. So now my kind of counts, because it's in a fantasy world, not a sci-fi one, where the main character is leveling up in a way.
Right.
Of course, I don't have any of the traditional plus 10 attack or that kind of thing, but he obviously levels up in gaining more levels.
No, now as an author, let me ask you, did you base your world on game mechanics of some sort?
The original writing of Slime Dungeon was based on game mechanics because the story that I drew inspiration from was a real, at the time I called it virtual reality story,
Okay.
rather than LitRPG is a new term, even for me still. Not sure where it came from actually, but the original book was based in a game world, so some of my things came from there. But when I was rewriting the first book, I took out a bunch of the stuff. You can still see like the blue screens are left over from that, but
Yeah.
it's more of its own genre. It's a dungeon genre story.
Okay, perfect. Is it okay if I ask you some LitRPG questions then?
Sure,
Like
go
that?
ahead.
Okay, so do you read LitRPG?
I read your story.
Okay. Just to address your comment earlier about the rules changing a little bit. Originally, and for the this is mostly for the audience. Originally, Alaron Kong, who is a LitRPG author, and he created the LitRPG Facebook group. His original kind of guidelines for LitRPG were a little rigid in that he said it has to be a video game world, and the characters are leveled by video game genres. And he basically just changed it from a video game to game mechanics, which to me seems more accurate because the genre, while that's an important aspect of it, doesn't necessarily have to be a video game. It can be a fantasy world like yours and mine, because mine isn't a video game world either, but the world is ruled by essentially video game mechanics that people can understand if they're gamers. And I think that's kind of the draw of the RPG part of LitRPG. Now, also to answer your question about where LitRPG came from, as somebody who has a podcast about LitRPG and who's interviewed a bunch of authors, the closest answer I can give you, my friend, is Vasily Mahenko, author of the Way of the Shaman series. When I interviewed him, he said that he and I think Alexei Bobble came up with the term in Russia. Like, it was called other things. Like, this kind of genre storytelling, it's been around for decades and decades, going back to the 80s, original virtual reality boom then, when people thought that virtual reality was going to be a thing. Stories started being written just like it is now, about people being immersed in virtual reality and all the great story and living opportunities available then. It didn't really take off, but he said that he came up with the term LitRPG in Russia as a way to describe this kind of storytelling, because it was becoming a really boom genre in Russia at the time, again drawing influences from Japan and other international works. And so, because he started writing a book specifically about essentially a video game world, but he revealed the video game mechanics, and other authors were doing the same thing, that's where they came up with literary RPG. That's essentially what it is. They smashed the words together and it became LitRPG, and that's kind of the title that we've all drawn from. And it's only really come to the United States in the last, I'd say, 3 or 4 years. That's when the first stories started to get translated into English from Japan and Russia, and then a few authors from the United States started to write in that genre as well. And since then, there's been not a super ton, but relative to what it was, like, I'm reading 3 to 4 books a week minimum, sometimes as much as 8 new lit RPG stories in our genre. So it's definitely becoming more and more popular. So there you go. I know that was a longer qu answer than you're probably looking for, but for the audience, if they don't know,
It
that's
answers the question.
yeah, absolutely. Okay, so you said you don't really read lit RPG then. What do you read then?
Everything.
Everything.
I mean, if I use fantasy as a general term, everything.
Everything. Perfect. Okay. So, are there any books that you're reading now? 'Cause I know as an author, sometimes authors don't have time to read anymore. Do you still find that you have time to read?
I think I have like 50 or so books I'm reading.
So I'd say, yeah, you probably have time to read if you're into 50 or so books. Any favorites in the group?
Let's see. The tastes vary month to month. For the past quite a few months, I've been in the Wuxia. So all those translated stories and similarly like Martial God Azura. There's a good one that is actually light lit RPG. Gate of Revelation. I Shall Seal the Heavens. Coiling Dragon. All sorts of things on the internet, which which I actually got into because of like the legendary Moonlight Sculpture.
Mm-hmm.
That was my gateway into the world of translated novels, which led me to the Russian translated novels on Amazon and thus to LitRPG.
Okay, perfect. So you do read LitRPG then? Okay, I wasn't sure.
I count that under the genre of fantasy, just
okay.
Sci-fi fantasy.
Okay, no, that's for perfect. I didn't want to put you on the spot about LitRPG if you didn't actually read it as a genre. Just so you know, I totally consider your book LitRPG, even under any definition. To me, LitRPG has two simple qualifications. Your world is ruled by game rules of some kind. Your character mm-hmm. progresses according to those rules. And that generally means level up notifications, blue screens, mm-hmm. Notifications, skills, whatever. Not necessarily, but as long as you qualify those two things, you can have any kind of story you want, in my opinion, and you'll still be LitRPG. You might not be good LitRPG, but you're at least LitRPG. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so let me ask you what you said. I think you already answered this question. I was going to ask you, what was the first LitRPG story that you kind of came across that you're like, this is special?
That would be Royal Roads, Don't Fear the Reaper.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Now, why was that so special to you?
Well, for a long time, it was the top of the list
mm-hmm.
for Royal Road. It isn't anymore, and I don't think the author is updating it anymore. And he rarely ever updated it in the first place, like once a month.
Right.
But it was a good story. It had the character. It had him go through an event. It had him partner with somebody. Sort of see where that is. And they do good things in mm-hmm. the game. Granted, there's, less than 30 chapters, and he didn't get to do too much, but it was a good game. And beside that is the legendary Moonlight Sculptor, which is definitely the origin of all related stuff. It got me into Royal Road, and I would like to give a shout out to Royal Road right now. They're a wonderful place for starting authors. They helped me out. I love them to death. I love Wing. She's a good friend. And that's how I got started in reading and then eventually writing.
Perfect. Perfect. It sounds like a lot of the stories that you read are online stories from that community of Royal Road. Do you read Wattpad stories at all?
Wattpad?
Nope. Okay. That's the answer. No, then. Okay. Yeah. So Royal Road seems like to be the big place for you, at least at this point. There's tons of communities, whether it's novel updates or the Royal Road or Wattpad, where
people like novel updates. Yeah.
Yeah. Where people, either upload novel updates more along the lines like translated international stories that are being translated in English by, you know, nonprofit fan groups for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
And the Royal Road is basically for the audience, of course, this is what this explanation is a place where people will update just amateur fiction of any kind whatsoever. There are no restrictions on it whatsoever, as far as I'm aware of. But you update your story, audience members hopefully find your stuff, and they can kind of boost you up in rankings as far as like the listing on the front page, but what's popular, what's interesting, and that kind of gives you a feel about what your story is. And of course, readers can comment on your individual chapters that you update and give you either criticisms or, oh, you made a spelling error here, or this is great, when's the next story kind of stuff. And so it's also a great resource for feedback as well. I personally uploaded when I was testing out the market to see if any would be interested in my story either. And it kind of gave me an opportunity, like, oh yeah, people like this, I'll continue writing and eventually publish. And I think that's the way it is for a lot of, especially first time writers, where they're not sure whether somebody's going to be interested in their story or not. That's a great place to start because it's very low pressure. There's nobody saying, oh, I had to pay money for your book. It's all free. Everybody understands that. So that's the agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let me ask you then, related to the statement you made previously, that's where you started on it. What inspired you? What actually made you go from reader to writer?
D&D. Which is funny. So it was in the spring of 2015. This was my second Dungeons & Dragons game I've ever done. And it was some of the most interesting stuff that could happen during a game, because I messed up as a cleric. I thought I had access to a level 9 spell at level 9, and only reason I went from level 1 to level 9 is because I encouraged my minotaur friend to destroy this part of the world in a completely unforeseen accident that involved magic, gravity, and a large hole in the ground.
So you, let me ask, this sounds like such a fascinating story. I have to get a few more details from you. Okay, so this, you weren't running the campaign. You were a player?
No. Okay. So I was the gnome cleric.
Okay, so you're a gnome cleric here. And just for you, for folks who, this is Dungeons & Dragons is a tabletop role-playing game where they roll dice, have character sheets. He's kind of essentially the real-life version of what we write in LitRPG. This is, that's what this is, folks. And so a lot of people draw inspiration from this for their stories. So I personally have never played a Dungeons & Dragons tabletop game, and I'm sadder for it because I draw a lot of information from the rule books, which I read all of them off. I just can never find a group. So I hear you, man, on like this being your second thing and like kind of making some errors. But I'm curious, like, so you went from level, what, like 1 to 9 overnight because of like one event? Is that what happened?
We wiped out like over 250 hydras in a single blow, and also wiped out the ecosystem and destroyed the underground water. It was a disaster. It was a major disaster. We changed the entire landscape at level, may not have been level 1. It may have been level 3 or 4. Because we were from the Underdark.
Yeah, yeah. I'm hearing you. And this can only really happen in like a flexible game like Dungeons & Dragons. Or like,
well, yeah, when you roll story, a 20 on that.
Yeah, you. This would never happen like a real video game because the rules would prevent this kind of stuff. But like flexible storytelling that Dungeons & Dragons allows, like this can totally happen. Like you can, my God, did your DM like hate you guys? Or was he like, oh my God, you guys are amazing.
He threw his head there like, congratulations, you destroyed this part of the world. Yep. I was like, I had an entire story for you guys to do underground. Well, you just cut off all paths back to your city for 50 miles.
No, I can only imagine his face. And he's like, you jerks. I can't believe you. The entire campaign is done. Thanks a lot. Here's your experience points. Go home.
So the point being is from there,
okay,
I misunderstood something. So I thought I had a level 9 spell. And I turned animals into people and had them work as our slaves and servants. And then they had children that were half people, half animal. Basically, everything I'm telling you, that was my first story. After we finished the campaign, I wrote it on Royal Road as my first story. It's called The Adventures of Valgrim, who is the name of my particular character.
Yeah.
It was honestly pretty crappy. I think to this day, I only have 50 followers.
It sounds absolutely fascinating to me, man. I got to say, I want to go read it now. Is this still on the Royal Road?
It's not that good. It's still there. It's not that good. Some chapters, like 500 words. Mm-hmm. First author, for your other authors out there, 2,000 words is a good goal to go for a chapter length.
I hope to reach that goal someday, my friend. Sometimes my chapters are really short. That's just my writing schedule, but I hear you.
Yeah. Anyway, back to that. So I wrote that. I got decent feedback, more like it was interesting, not that it was good.
Yeah.
And that led to my first major story on Royal Road. It's called Hero of Naught.
Mm-hmm.
You probably haven't read it. It's kind of old. I wrote that during the summer when I was working at the university. This one is a real, in your terms, LitRPG novel. At the time, I called it virtual reality.
Yep.
In my mind, that still kind of is, just because.
That's what it was when you wrote it. So it's always going to be that thing in your mind.
So it was my take on virtual reality. The story involved a character in a future. The first entire chapter was a huge info dump about how that future came to be, so that was pretty crappy. And he's in a virtual world, and he gets wrecked, and he ends up horribly paralyzed, and he has to live in the virtual world.
Okay, so there's like a real life correlation between like actual damage and real life damage then. Is that what you're...
Yeah, okay, real life that he could only move his head. He got beat up by bullies.
So he was paralyzed in real life.
Yes.
And so he goes into virtual reality like, oh, look, I can move my legs and arms again. And then he gets beat up again in the virtual reality game. Is that what you did?
No. Well, it was supposed to be a dark story. But
yeah, this sounds dark.
With my personality that you've seen in the slime dungeon, it didn't work out that way. He ended up making friends with a bunny. And in my universe, these are demon bunnies. They have massive fangs. These are not for noobs. He ends up befriending one, helping it out, and it turns into a rabbit beast girl who decides to partner up with him. And she is completely OP at the start of the book. You know, you look back at what you write, and you're like, oh my gosh, why did they do that? Point being is that yada, 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 they go through, they beat some demon wargs, so you can sort of see some of that carrying over. She ends up trapped, for some reason this isn't charging, in a dungeon. And when in the second book, when he goes to rescue her, she has become a corrupted dungeon spirit. Mm-hmm. And then the theoretical third book would have been him traveling. The problem with the entire series was that it didn't focus on the game elements. The NPCs acted like real people, and I had entire sections of chapters from their perspective. Made no sense. And also, it got too fast. You know, when you're writing a book and the pace gets too quick, you either end up in OP land or there's nothing interesting to write about anymore and you drop it.
Right. You need breaks in between those right. battles. Otherwise, it's just curve. There's a really big
right.
power curve, which is what some literary stories have an issue with. So unless you have those little breaks where you can like reset, that does tend to happen. I absolutely agree. So it sounds right. like you've learned a lot from your previous writing experiences on the railroad, so much so that you felt comfortable actually publishing something on right. Amazon as a slam dunk. So I got to say, I'm really happy that you've improved as a writer. I mean, from what you said, you didn't just jump in like knucklehead me, who was like, oh, I'm going to write a story and I'm going to put it on Amazon. Yeah. And that's what it was. Looks like you took the time to actually kind of craft your, you know, hone your skills a little bit online. So I applaud that.
Don't applaud it. I waited 5 months and then wrote a story for a NaNoWriMo.
Right.
And it was good.
It's a pathway.
Yeah, I guess. I might go back someday and make the first book a little better, but you never know.
You never know. They're story ideas, they're sitting there, but you made that big step. I got to say, there are literally hundreds and thousands of people in the world who are like, I have a story in my head, but I'm not good enough as a writer. So it stays there. But you, as an author, you as a person, you made that leap, whether it was a leap of faith into the online community or eventually on Amazon, actually publishing a novel and people paying you to do it. That leap is not something that everybody does. And so it's totally admirable, and it's okay to say you did something special that not everybody does or can. Okay. Thank you very much for the information about your beginnings as an author. Now, going back to just some writer details about how you write, what's your schedule like? Tell me about your methodology as a writer. Do you have like a set schedule you do, like 1,000 words every day or something? What's your process as a writer?
That would depend on what time of the year I'm writing. Back when I wrote book two, for instance, I wrote a chapter, went to work, came back home, wrote another chapter. Knocked that out in half a month. Back when I wrote book one, I wrote a chapter a day. Right now, well, I didn't really write the first 15 chapters in a set period of time because I kept taking breaks for school.
Right.
I'm going to try to finish this book by writing a chapter a day, and if that doesn't work out, then I'll make it up on the weekends to at most two a day.
And so when you say a chapter, you're saying you write approximately 2,000 words a day or per chapter?
At least 2,000 is what I try to go for. Sometimes I'll write half a chapter at 2,000 words and the other half in another 2,000. It just makes a big chapter.
Right, okay.
Try to write 2,000 words a day is the goal in the end.
Perfect. That sounds like a really ambitious schedule. I don't know that I could write 2,000 words a day. Like some really good days when I have like a really great story idea, like it's easy. But other days it's like I don't feel like writing descriptions for items or the, you know, telling about the descriptions of the room or something. So it's a little bit harder for me.
I consider that part of the work, and I didn't start off doing it that way. At NaNoWriMo, I had to write at least 1,667 words every day to meet the deadline qualifications for the contest. So I just upgraded that to an even 2,000, And book one was 62,000 words. Book two is 84,000 words. And while I thought that was big, all these big lit RPG authors have like almost double that. Like, I know Travis has got huge amount of words. I said that wrong, but it doesn't matter.
No, his words are very hugely massive. I agree. No, like my story is like 120,000 words. I'm just a wordy guy, I guess. No, in all honesty,
see what I mean?
Yeah, that's just me though. Like, my chapters are really a bunch of subchapters that are smaller. Like my subchapters are usually at least 1,000 words each, but mm-hmm. I put them on like larger chapters that end up being like 10,000 words, like a piece, and like 10,000 word chapters is easily 100,000 words. And that's kind of how I gauge my goal of like what I wanted to write as far as like lengthwise goes. But that's just my brain being an amateur. Like, I literally had never written anything creative in my entire life before I wrote the story. So I didn't really have any boundaries or guidelines to kind of go through. So that's just what I did, man. It's not other authors write other things. I think other authors write smaller, more compact stories, or just better editors, because a lot of the stuff that I wrote were just like, this isn't really necessary. Like, it's great. Like, it's a great word count, and it's not like it's unnecessary. Like, it adds something to the genre and to the story, of course. But other authors are like, this is a lot of unnecessary stuff here that kind of slows down your story a little bit. And so I think just because your story is smaller, just less of a word, doesn't mean you're a worse writer. It's just maybe you're a better editor than some of the longer books like mine.
Well, a good goal for any starting author is that the first Harry Potter book is about 60,000 words.
Yeah.
Just aim for that for your first book. You're golden.
Absolutely. I wish I could squeeze my story into 60,000 words, though. It requires, like I said, I don't really have like a ton of editing skills. I barely have writing skills. So to trim it out that much, I don't know that it's possible for me. Like right now I'm close to 20,000 words and I'm still in my first chapter. I think I might have to break it up into two separate things just so 1, it makes a little more.
1,000 words for one chapter?
I told you, man. I'm not a real writer. I'm just a guy who writes stories. So like my first scene, like my first progressive scene is like, it's literally coming up on like 20,000 words. And in my brain, this is like one chapter. And I might break it up into two, but in my brain, it's like, I'm writing the first chapter and I haven't done like a ton. Like I don't want to spoil the story, but like I've accomplished a few things. I've reminded my audience about like what happened in the last book, and I've set up like, okay, this is the world that we're going into because they're traveling to a new place. So I have to do like descriptions about that and create emotional setup, like, oh, because I remind myself that not everybody's going to have read the first book, so I have to describe at least a little bit about who these characters are and why they're doing this one thing. And so maybe it's too wordy, but it's kind of all I know how to do.
Nah, it seems to fit you.
Yeah. I agree absolutely with you, man. Okay, so we talked a little bit about your structure. What kind of writer are I'm in talking to writers, I tend to categorize them as two types, and while this is very broad, either as an outliner, somebody who has everything plotted out in advance, or as a pantser. It's you fly by the seat of your pants and you kind of make up the story as you write it. Which one are you?
I use the same two categories. I have planned authors and inspirational authors.
Yeah.
I am primarily an inspirational author.
Okay.
I do not plan out the individual chapters that I write. I might plan out like the end plot points, mm-hmm. or a general idea, but when I type, I just say my fingers are typing the story. My brain has zero control over anything past the current word I'm typing.
Yeah, perfect. So yeah, I'm kind of the same way. In the first book, especially for me, because it was the first time doing creative writing, mm-hmm. I was very much a fly by the seat of the pants. Every chapter, I didn't know exactly what was going to happen the next chapter. It kind of came up with it as I was writing, very much so. Mm-hmm. With it seemed like midway through, I'm like, this hit, nothing's really happening. So I came up with like a few plot points. Like, I wanted to go to a dungeon and do something there and like explore a town. And at the very end, I came up with that beforehand. And so I had a kind of creative experience that led them there. Mm-hmm. But that was kind of it. Everything else in between was kind of just made up, or it was a little more inspirational. Like, I would be inspired by something I watched or wrote, like, that's awesome, I'm putting that in the story. And that's what came to be. Like, this for book two, it's very much a different experience because
you have a story, and now you have to plan around the story.
Sort of, yeah, yeah, very much so, because I have something to build from.
Right.
And so in this instance, I have a good starting point that's already kind of set up. But at the same time, I also want to be a better writer because this is if I do something, I want to be good at it. And I want to be improve. That's right. Just me. So I started reading some like writing tip books. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that he all mentioned is like, have an outline, at least like where you're going to go. It doesn't have to be completely filled. Every detail doesn't have to be written, but you should have some, you know, mile markers to know when you've reached certain events. So the audience has like some kind of structure, you know, peaks and valleys kind of thing about action, adventure, plot points and all that. I'm like, okay, that makes sense. I wish somebody would have told me for book one, but this is hopefully be a better book.
And so I'll give you a quick example there. You know, Fiora and Mary in my book, I did not plan for them to be related in any familial way.
Oh,
that popped up when I was just typing that chapter. Which is why when I did the editing, I had to go back and add little hints here and there.
Because otherwise, it's just kind of sudden.
It's like, oh my God, what?
Yeah, and that happens sometimes too with author stories. Like, where did this come from? There was no lead up here. It's just, it feels like something like very much like inspiration. Like, oh, I'll put this in there. And then it's like, where did it come from? I broke my tooth on that bit. Yeah. Okay, So you got that question. Thank you very much for that answer. It's nice to know that I'm not the only person who doesn't plan everything out. That makes me feel a little bit better. Let me ask you about, again, another writing question. What's the easiest and hardest thing as a writer for you?
The easiest thing is, let's start around. The hardest thing is sitting down and typing.
Yeah.
The easiest thing is that once you start typing, you don't stop unless something really distracts you. Editing sucks, but it's necessary.
I think that's a universal truth for most writers, that editing sucks.
Yep. That's about it for those, but I can tell you the funnest thing.
Okay.
The funnest thing is reading people's happy comments about what you've written.
And I'm not 100% sure if you're being facetious, but comments are very interesting. They're at least good feedback, if nothing else. They give you a nice point of view from your reader's viewpoint, like whether the story idea works or whether it's a giant plot hole or whether they first saw it because it was too obvious. So I personally actually really love the beta reader's feedback. Not so much everybody's feedback in the entire world, which is what you get sometimes on the rural road. Sometimes it's just like people being mean to be mean. They're trolls.
The community's done pretty well on there.
Yeah.
I say this to defend them, not to interrupt you. I apologize for that.
No. I'm not saying they're a bad community. Quite the opposite. Yeah. Like 99% of the people on Rural Road are really constructive. They're like really supportive. They're like, hey, good job. When's the next chapter? Appreciate it. Or, hey, I like this idea. Mm-hmm. Or like, mm-hmm. I have this question about your story. Like, what's the details behind? Like, they're legitimately curious. But like that 1% sticks in my brain every single time I get like some trolley comment and they're like, this is the worst story in the world, you should go die. And I'm like, that was completely unnecessary, jerk.
That happened to me and my rank suffered as a result of all the bad reviews, and I've never recovered. Poor Blaze seems to be going through that at the moment, if Facebook is to be believed.
Is he? I don't know that that's quite the case. I gave him a great review. Were you talking about his story, the Luckstat Secret of the Old One, or like Delver's LLC?
I think his new one, the Luckstat one.
Really?
All it takes is one person to hate, and then like everybody who hates falls in behind them, and they add their fuel to the fire.
Well, that's too bad. I haven't read that on Amazon personally. I really liked his story. I had criticisms like all stories that I read and that I review. I have, you know, this could be done better. It's not never negative, but it's like, I would have liked to have seen this or this, but I love these things, especially. That's the kind of reviewer I am in general.
Yep.
But not everybody's like that. Some people, and maybe as an author, honestly, as an author, I don't read the reviews. I don't read the one-star reviews specifically because they'll just stick in my mind like a burr and I can't get rid of them. And that's just me as a human being.
Yeah.
I'm cool with criticism, like especially if it's constructive criticism. Like this mm-hmm. could be done better, but like just like the whole troll comments, I'm like, no, I'll avoid them.
Useful.
Yeah, they're not beneficial, and so mm-hmm. I just kind of avoid those kind of things. That's just me. But it saddens me to see that an author I like and I consider a friend is getting some of those negative comments. But hey, every reader has the right to give an opinion.
Yep. That's true. Unfortunately,
especially if you're paying money for your stuff, you know? Yeah. Okay. On to their next question. Writer's block, my friend. Do you ever get writer's block?
I mean, if you're talking about whenever I don't feel like writing, then a lot.
Oh, but I think that's the general state of writers. Like, they almost never feel like writing, but once you start, it's just like it flows. At least right. It does for me. But it's literally a block.
It's like Sisyphus in Hades. You got to push that rock up to the top of the hill, and then when it's up there, it falls down and goes all the way down.
Okay. So do you actually ever get writers? Like, do you ever get stuck for story ideas?
Oh, not for story ideas. Mostly just the actual writing process. I think that's a benefit over planned writers as opposed to inspirational. You don't necessarily need an idea to start. You just need to push yourself, and your fingers will give you that inspiration to start. But okay, planned writers, I think, have it easier because once they have an idea, it's a lot easier for them to start writing.
Yeah, because they have somewhere to start and they have somewhere to go. And so all the writing is the stuff in between, the detail work, the description, the dialogue, all the good stuff. And I feel that you're right. That is kind of an advantage of a planner versus a seat of your pants kind of person, that you don't get stuck sometimes. At least that's the way it's a little easier as far as like for me writing this second time around than it is the first time around, because I have plot points. Like, I have my mark. Like, I say, that's where I'm going to go. So this is where my writing has to take me. And while I still struggle for the detail work, like the descriptions and how people get there, it's much easier when you have a place to go in mind. You have, you know, you can plan your path out at that point. But if you don't have that goal, you don't have absolutely any idea where your story's going. Then it's like, it's hard to kind of conceptualize it and make those ideas that are floating around your brain into a concrete story. So I like the fact that you only occasionally get, you know, writer's block. But if you get writer's block, what do you do to get around it?
I wait until it's gone.
Hey, that's perfect. I know some authors are like, a nice Coke and gin works for me, my friend.
Sometimes I need a kick in the pants.
Yeah? What's your kick in the pants?
Family or readers.
Readers, that's a big thing, especially for I think that's one of the things I like about the online community, especially if you're publishing on a regular basis on something like Railroad, where people are expecting the next chapter on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. They kind of give you motivation saying, hey, where's the next story? I love your stuff, but where is it? Where is it? Where is it? Where is it? And at some point you're like, ah, okay, here it is. Mm-hmm. And I think Blaze Corp, the guy we're talking about, who's the author of Delvers LLC and Secret of the Old One series, which he just published, kind of felt the same way. But his point of view was very much from Patreon. He set up a Patreon account, which is a way for readers or content creators to get paid for their work through voluntary monthly donations from their reader bank or from their users. And so because of that monetary pressure, even if it's only a couple bucks, he feels kind of an obligation to his readers, saying, okay, you're literally giving me money, even if it's like a buck or two, to write you something. So I feel that pressure to write. Mm-hmm. And so I think that that's his part of his motivation in continuing that regular process. But forever, every author has to find their own motivation. Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect. So we got writer's block. Okay, perfect. We've talked about some of your reading habits already. Publishing. This is a good question for just writers in general. You are publishing on both the Railroad and you're self-publishing on Amazon. Is there a particular reason you chose to go the self-publishing route as opposed to traditional publishers?
Because I was shot down.
Oh, okay. Did you really submit something to like a real publisher and they didn't like it?
I sent the original Hero of Not In. In retrospect, of course it was going to get shot down. I tried Slime Dungeon, but nobody was interested in the idea. I considered, you know, paying to publish for a while.
Oh, like the vanity publisher thing?
Sort of like that, yeah. Right. But then I had no money, so that didn't work out. So then I just did it through Amazon because it was free. And Scott Cawthon.
Remind me of what he wrote.
He is an author of a variety of Scott-related stories, like Galactic Fist of Legend.
I know who you're talking about. Is his writer name Scott Cawthon, or is like Scotty Munch or something?
Wait, what? Scott Cawthon is the creator of Five Nights at Freddy's.
It's okay, man. I get names mixed up all the time. I know who you're talking about, though. Okay, yeah. So go on.
The other Scott. Oh, this is embarrassing. He is, I consider him a friend.
Ugh. No, he's a nice guy. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah.
Yeah. I had the opportunity to help him when he was writing Galactica Crystallium. I can never pronounce that. I actually helped create monster evolution charts for him.
Oh, so that's nice.
Which sort of inherited in the slime dungeon, but I created a variety of monster girl related things. He published on Amazon, and I did ask him for a little advice, and he said he liked it, and I decided to take a chance because nobody was going to do it traditionally. I didn't have any money to do it third party, so might as well do it myself.
Perfect. That's a great answer. And I think that's the answer for a lot of LitRPG authors like myself who are not role writers. I mean, I don't think of myself as a role writer. I'm just a guy who wrote a story in my brain and got lucky.
Yeah, you have the suit. That's the other part.
Although it's not in my author. Well, I think it is in my author page, actually. But yeah, I got the suit to go along with it. But that's the exact reason I self-publish, is that I didn't think traditional publishers aren't interested in LitRPG currently. They're becoming more so as they realize their dollars there. And the third party publishing, like the vanity publishing, where you're paying to get your book put out there, is just out of the reach of most first-time authors because they don't have money. They're real people with real jobs, and they have real bills. And so self-publishing kind of bridges the gap between them. It's like there's no barrier to entry. You put your stuff out there for free. Amazon takes the biggest cut of it. You get like between 40 or 70%, depending on how you organize your choices.
Right.
And you get that as royalties. And so it works out for Amazon. They get the bulk of the money. You get a really steady income. If you went with the traditional publisher, right here, it's something along the lines of anywhere between royalty rates of 10 to 30 or 40% at the max.
Yeah, that's correct.
You kind of get the same deal. It's just that, you know, real publisher, traditional publisher does all the legwork of marketing and,
right,
you know, all that stuff. And as a self-publisher, you got to be that person yourself. You got to do your own marketing. And if you're not lucky enough to have like an in with the crowd, like us, as a lot of PG authors, we just kind of put our stuff on and they grab it before we even like really recognize that they're there. It's really hard and difficult and challenging. And some people have to make a living this way. And so they search for different markets to self-publish, which is what's happening currently. We're getting a lot of new, sometimes great, sometimes not so nice authors into LitRPG community. And we hope they all do well, but we also hope they also serve the community from a place of good nature, passion. And
That's,
we know not everybody's going to be that way.
Yeah. But I remember when I first put out Slime Dungeon, that was early 2016. There wasn't a lot up there in terms of video game stories or really any big things at all. Let's see, there was like End Online.
There was Way of the Shaman. There was
What's his name?
Play to Live. Way of the Shaman or Play to Live?
Let's see. It was by Brent.
Brent Roth. You mean the Wrath of the Dragon?
Yeah. And David. Oh wait, no. He didn't write a light RPG, but it was Daniel Black wrote a couple of good ones. So that's not light RPG. That's Transported to Another World. And
yeah, I was going to say that's not quite light RPG. There's no game mechanic, I think, there. But you're right. There wasn't a lot
in that. But
even in the last year, there has been a ton of growth. But when you started in 2016, not a lot of guys out there.
The wolf one. Shoot, what was that? Remember, this was about a war game one. It had a wolf's head for the first book, and then the second one had four wolf's heads.
Oh, you mean that the futuristic one? World of War. I believe this. I do this for. I kind of do this, man. 20 hours a week.
Yeah.
Seven. You know.
And then D. Ross. I think D. Ross had his first one or two books out.
Which was the Play to Live series, right? Yeah.
Yep. So there was not a lot out there. So that's one of the main reasons why I don't think Slime Dungeon was part of that, because they were all very obviously video games.
Yeah, they were very much virtual reality video game based kind of LitRPG. So I understand what you're saying.
That was the environment at the time. So I only did well because Royal Road was there. especially since back in when I wrote the second book of June, I was the top author story on Railroad for the entire month. Like 500,000 people read the story. Naturally, I have since lost that popularity, and because of the trolls, I am way down in the polls, but it's still a good story, in my opinion. But that's the only way I was able to market it, right? I don't know that that many people in real life. I especially even know less people willing to, as you said at the very beginning of this interview, spend my cold, hard cash on a new series.
Yeah, so absolutely. I think one of the big things that Amazon has for as far as a benefit for writers, especially new authors, is the Kindle Unlimited program. If you're not coming from an established user base like on the Railroad where you have 500,000 readers subscribing to your story on a regular basis, it's hard to get people to give your story a chance because they have to pay real money for it. But if they're using Kindle Unlimited where they feel like they can read all the stories they want for the low price of $9.99 a month, they're more likely to say, oh, this looks like a cool cover. I'll open up with the book and give it a chance. And for me personally, that was half of my success. The first half of my success is just people in the LitRPG community, mostly from the Facebook group, a little bit from Railroad, but mostly for just people on the Facebook saying, hey, I know that dude, he wrote a story, I'll give him a shot. And then, you know, the Amazon algorithm said, oh, this guy has some readers, and so we'll bump it up a little bit. And the cycle continued. But most of the good press was from people just giving it a chance on Kindle Unlimited. So I think a very similar experience is the Railroad. It's a free place for people to read stories, so they're very willing to give it a chance and to follow it if they have even the smallest amount of interest in it. And that creates a nice user base. So when you publish, oh, even if it's only a fraction of that 500,000 people coming to actually purchase your story, that's still a really good amount of people.
And that was a very small fraction of that 500,000 people. The big risk when you do that kind of thing, of course, is that they've read the story. They don't feel like they need to buy it to read it again.
That is definitely the risk when you give it out for free. But I found like the people who are really like your core, hardcore fans, they're like, I love this story so much for free. I will pay this dude just to say thank you. Yeah. And whether it's through a donation box or through a Patreon subscription or through just like buying your book when it actually comes out or buying a Kindle Unlimited, whatever it is, that core group of hardcore fans, they're willing to do that because they appreciate the hard work and the entertainment that you gave them when it was free.
That's good, Trish. I agree.
Absolutely. Okay, so great stuff. So I appreciate you taking the time to talk to me about those things. And you said you don't really do marketing, so I don't know if I can give you any real marketing questions. Do you have any marketing tips for people?
Well, this is mostly for first-time authors. If you have written a story and you don't know if people like it, then a site like Royal Road, or you've given some other ones, Novel Updates, Wattpad, and if people like your story, and I would judge this about, let's see, I had over 2,000 followers, and as you can see, 2,000, 500,000, not everybody follows your stuff. And if you can get over 10,000 average views per chapter, I would say that means you have a good story that is worth publishing. Because if you get a small fraction, as you say, you can make some money off that. But for marketing purposes, no, I do not have that much experience beyond Royal Road. And I looked at Amazon's, like, you pay like 49 cents to pop up and compete with other people. I did that for a month. I didn't see a real difference.
Yeah, I'm testing that out myself for my story. I'm like, because my sales have gone from the first month, like, oh, really nice. And they're like going on the downslope now on both like purchases and like Kindle Unlimited. I'm like, oh, well, I might think about doing marketing at this point now. I did had a really good first month, of course, but now I want to continue praying to people doing it. And I'm trying to figure out how to do it. And I don't have the experience to like do it.
My advice to you would be to get your second book out. If you just have one book, don't really worry about marketing too much because you don't have that much to market at this point. Yeah, at least two books. And then that can show, especially if you get good reviews, that shows you have quality work that's worth marketing.
That's a good piece of advice. Don't focus so much on marketing, especially with the first book only being out. Or if you're not having a first book, focus on writing the book first before you do marketing concerns. But for me, I'm like, this is a thing on Amazon. I've never done it. I'm like devoting like $5 a day at like 25 cents a click or something. So it's not like a huge investment of money. And maybe that's my issue. I need to put my money into, but I figure start out small and change the variables a little bit from week to week to see if there's like an actual change. And if I just lose the money, like it doesn't matter, then it's not a ton of money for me to lose. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So I think that's also good. Like if you're going to test something out, test it in small batches. Fiverr is a great place to test marketing tools or like marketing opportunity because they're $5 a piece. Social media is for free. So I think that's also a great place. Like our Facebook group, LitRPG, is where our authors and our readers kind of meet. So it's kind of a natural place to like say, here's a book. Go read it if you like it. But it's also a place that you're going to get reamed if it's not really LitRPG and you're just trying to be a user. Or if it's a bad LitRPG story, people are going to say, don't read this. And so your sales aren't going to increase from that particular aspect. But also Twitter, other places like, you know, blogs are also, I know a lot of authors, this is just something I'm discovering as I'm like researching this stuff. Like a lot of authors use newsletters or like email chains or like email letter lists. Is that something you do?
No.
Okay. Just curious. Cause it was something like, is that something I'm supposed to be doing? When I read like other people talking about it, either on Facebook or like in books about, or like podcasts about marketing, like their big thing is like, oh, you have to have like this, you know, 100,000, you know, list of email subscribers so you can send out your newsletter blast when your new book comes out, and that'll be a thing for you. And that might be a very good marketing tool. I just don't have experience with it. So like I have a LitRPG newsletter that goes through my site for like Geek Bites podcast. And I put up a thing there so I can send people emails about like new LitRPG stuff, but I have like 30 subscribers, you know? And so for me, it's like, I'm okay with that. Like, I'm really okay with like people, only 30 people signing for the newsletter because they get the same information on the podcast. It's just they get like a day early. But for, I feel like if people are interested in a thing, I'll provide the opportunity for them. But for me, the newsletter thing is not like a major source of, you know, reader interest. For me, it's, you know, Facebook. It's like maybe an author page that I have, and that's kind of growing. I think I have 60 followers on the author page, which is not a huge deal either. But I figure like that's a better opportunity in the era of social media for people to get instantaneous updates and to check back on a regular basis because it shows up in your feed and you're already on Facebook anyway. So I think that is increasingly becoming a new opportunity for authors to connect to their readers, not just through emails that might get filtered out. So I'm glad you agree. Sorry, I kind of go on my own tangents. Okay, so those are all the author questions that I have. Here's one more question about new authors that I kind of came up based upon some of the stuff happening online and new authors coming in. You've had success as a LitRPG author, okay? So based on the recent influx of new authors to the LitRPG market, I think whether they're successful or not, there have been a lot. So if you could give another author one piece of advice specifically about writing in the LitRPG genre, what would it be?
Please find more people to read your book.
Oh, you mean as beta readers? As like beta readers, you're like, okay, that's actually amazingly good because they can test the right, because a lot of people come from other genres, but they have different things that they write about, whether it's a romance novel genre or thrillers or whatever. And those, each one of those genres have their own things that they have to be successful or to be interesting to those readers. Mm-hmm. And LitRPG is no different. But if you're coming from those other genres, you're used to writing in a certain style. And if you try to translate them directly into RPG, it doesn't seem to work because we expect different things. And we're more permissive with other things that we don't care about. We're really cool with like small grammar errors or spelling errors as a community. But we're not cool with like you're not including game mechanics, you know, or just making it a virtual reality fantasy. Like we'll call you out and say, this is not LitRPG, this is video game fiction, or this is, you know, this is just portal fantasy, you know, that kind of stuff. So I think you're right that them testing with the market first on the real road or through a beta reader group is a really good way for them to test their ideas. I like that.
Another one, please don't write in the eyes of a culture you do not understand. There's too many people these days like trying to make a Japanese anime when they don't understand how the Japanese live.
Or they've never, you know, really watched anime. That's always an issue for me. Like, that's not what happens. That's weird. Why are you writing like that?
So girls don't run around and well, that's about it for that.
Or they're getting like certain tropes incorrectly like stated, like they'll watch like one harem anime and think that's all the anime in the world or something. I've seen that too.
Yeah, it's like real life doesn't work that way. Majority of animes don't work that way.
Yeah.
If they do, it's just because that's what people in America translate.
Or because it's that genre specific. Like, there's a genre of anime that's harem.
Yeah.
Harem anime, and that's cool. It also kind of leads into hentai a little bit for that kind of stuff. So it's a tricky thing to get correct without getting too lewd. And some authors don't understand that. It's the same with any creative process. Like you need a really wide base of information before you can start like grabbing tropes that work for you as an author, which is another piece of advice I would say. Read as much LitRPG as possible. Before you don't just read one story and say that's how it goes, because that's not how it works for everybody. It's very much, there are a lot of different little things that we've all kind of gathered as readers that we've decided I like this enough to put it in my own story. But we read, like me personally, I read in the last year and a half that I, you know, been doing the podcast or been doing a review. So like easily 300 books, like real full on Amazon books or Royal Road stories. And so going from reader to writer, that was a big foundation for me to draw from. And also, you know, 25, 30 years of gaming experience was also a goal, you know, a thing to draw from as far as a LitRPG author. And some authors don't have that background. They've never been gamers. They've never gone into anime or really read LitRPG. And so it's harder for them. I'm not saying it's impossible, but it's a bigger challenge for them because they don't have that basis of literally decades of experience in this kind of fictional geek community and culture. And so it's an extra challenge for them to kind of get it right and to please the audience. But if they put the work into it, they can totally do it. It's just a more challenging experience that sometimes I think they don't get. They see this genre as, oh, people are spending money. I'm going to write in that community and they're going to give me all their dollars. And that's not really the case.
Don't write a Star Wars story after watching Star Trek.
Yeah, that is amazingly accurate. I love that. Thank you very much. Okay, so those are all my author questions, man. We've already been talking for a great big long time. So we're going to go into the few questions from the audience, and then we're going to wrap it up, okay? Okay. Questions from the audience. We're going to begin with Travis Hoselton. I hope I'm seeing it right, man. I apologize if I'm not. He has a couple questions for you. He has three in particular. When is the next book? We kind of answered that already. So February release date, tentative, audiobook, end of February, March. Is that okay to say?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're cool. Because you don't have like an official pre-order thing on Amazon. So it's a little tentative at this moment. Okay. Here's a question you can answer, though. How many books do you have planned for your series?
Eh?
I'm like, is he deciding now at this instant how many books he's going to have? At least three, obviously.
I was going to throw out 10.
Okay. Is that like a serious answer? Like you actually have stories planned for 10, or that's like, oh, if I stay interested, 10 books?
It would likely go beyond 10. But I say 10 because I have an entire continent to explore, and I do plan on having done Doc Games some mode of transportation sometime in the future.
Oh,
I've revealed three different types of what a dungeon can do so far. Mm-hmm. There are more types to how a dungeon can get around places. I'm not going to tell them to you, but it'll be an interesting surprise. Maybe we'll see some more dungeon-on-dungeon action in the future.
Okay, perfect. That's perfect. Because I was curious, like, how's he going to do 10 dungeons if it's in the same place the entire time? That's a lot of interesting storytelling he's got to do. But if it's mobile, that makes sense.
Another thing is, Doc is technically immortal. As long as his crystal isn't broken, he'll live for a long time. So if I wanted to, I could make a huge time skip. I could put 100 years and all the original people outside the dungeon are dead. I could start an entirely new outside dungeon town story if I wanted to.
You could, if you're evil. I think
I even considered the possibility of writing the end of the story being, it was all a dream. He woke up from his coma. But then I figured that would just make so many people mad, just like what you just did.
I agree. That would have totally pissed off a lot of people. Not everybody. Some people are like, you got me. But most people would be like,
nah, but I do know the final ending for the story. I do know what Doc is going to become. I do know what all of his minions are going to become as well. There is an entire end goal, which I believe is the accumulation of what every dungeon story is trying to get to.
Okay, because I'm kind of curious. Like, a lot of dungeon stories just kind of run out of steam. Like, the ones that I'm referring to, like, right. The ones online, they just kind of, they write. The dungeon gets, you know,
powerful. They reach a point where it's not interesting, or they get too OP.
They get OP.
By OP, I mean overpowered to the general audience means it's so powerful, it's boring. It's like you go see a football game, and one team massacres the other to, like, 72-0. It's not interesting anymore.
Yeah.
It's not fun. Another example is, like, you play Overwatch and you have aimbot on the entire time. You kill everybody, become a master rank. It's boring.
Absolutely. I agree. And that's one of the draws of our genre, I think, is that journey of power, that ability to grow more powerful through hard work or through experience gain or through, you know, gaming the system, whatever you want to call it. But that journey is part of what draws the audience to our genre, because it's very much along our experiences as gamers. You put in the work, you have a power level progression, and if that's missing from your story, or you just go from here to here, it's not interesting. Or if that progression is too quick, if that curve power is too steep, then it's also not interesting. So there's a real interesting balancing act to have there. Although a few people can't do the OP story very well, like, you know, One Punch Man. That's like the one rare exception where overpowered is not a horrible thing.
He that author was a pretty good genius in that regard. He made the story interesting.
Absolutely. I think that's one of the most fascinating opportunities, fascinating stories for an overpowered character. It's like he starts out overpowered, but he's still utterly fascinating. And the actual combat still has that progression of difficulty, but the character himself is always that powerful. And to me, it is pure genius. And I can't wait for a second season to show up at some point in the future.
To say, I wanted to base my story progression around my favorite story, One Piece. One Piece is by far one of my favorite things to read or watch. Anime is also good. And that author has been writing the story for 15 plus years now. He actually married his wife, as she was cosplaying as Nami. That's always a plus for us authors.
You get to marry your character. That is a writer's dream, my friend.
Well, he just has the story progression so good. Right, he's got the individual traveling from island to island, and each island is its own story.
Right.
But then he goes, like, multiple islands are their own story, and now he's going multiple segments of that are their own story. See, there's a clear linear progression from weak to strong. The combat's interesting. He keeps all the details interesting. I think that's something all authors should aspire for.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. As far as, like, the character progression arc of his power structure, really good. I have other issues with One Piece in that the spaces between combat are a little bit long for me, especially in the anime form. That's an anime viewer's issue, not a writer's issue. But as far as character progression goes, you're absolutely correct. It's a wonderful arc, and especially for something that long, for that kind of series that's literally spans years and years and years of a manga writer's time, it's a really challenging thing to keep going. Okay, so next question, another question from Travis again, is going to be his last one. What made you decide to write about dungeons? He loves the aspect of your series. So what made you write about that dungeon? I think he might have sort of already answered this, but I'll let you go again.
There are a couple of aspects, all because of other stories. One thing is because of Hero of Knot, when I ended the original one. And I say original because I have rewritten the original story. It's new concept, same characters. And I will be publishing that eventually later this year. Anyway, so the end of the original book two of that series has one of the main protagonist friends become a dungeon. So add 4 months of not writing really anything. And then you know what? That was interesting. And on Royal Road, there were a couple of other interesting ones out. There was a Hold in the Wall by Groupie, who's deleted that, unfortunately. That was also Harem, by the way. There was, let's see, VR Draco did one. He's ended up going to OP land, but it was good beyond that. Let's see. Then there were at least two more that I can no longer remember. Master of Dungeon.
Yep, that one's really good. I talked to the author before, Justin Miller. He says he plans to publish that at some point.
He needs to finish it first.
Even if he published like the first half of it, I'd be okay with that. I mean, when you have a really long story, you have to have breaking points at some point. He can kind of rewrite a middle place and just kind of, you know, to be continued it. But he's kind of disappeared off the map. I'm a little concerned personally that I haven't heard back from him in a while. We were supposed to do like an interview and like some personal stuff. I haven't heard back from him since. So I'm like, I don't know if something happened or if he just lost interest in it or whatever, but I love that story as well.
Yeah. Okay. There's another one I don't remember. And then
basically the short answer is you were inspired by other writers to write your own dungeon story because you were a massive fan of the dungeon story genre. Is that fair to say?
That's fair to say. And I wanted to see how to properly progress a dungeon story. So it didn't end up in OP land.
So you were the, I can do better and you did better.
I'm not sure I can do better. I want to do better.
Okay, that's fair. That's fair, man. But I mean, that kind of motivation is not uncommon. I talked to Aloran Kong as an interview. He, that was basically his motivation. It was like, I kind of have a strum in my head. I've been reading a bunch of LitRPG, but I felt like I could do something better than some of the crap I read. And he put out a story. And for a lot of authors, it's the same thing. It's like, I want to do something better. I love this genre so much. I want to put good stuff out there because I'm reading some not so great stuff occasionally. And they were content takers and they wanted to be a creator. And that same motivation is the same for some people.
Yep. And also, as I mentioned, Scotty Fulci's, I helped create the monster chart over there.
Yep.
It was a big inspiration for you, yeah. For his monster Pokemon harem girl story.
He does some really interesting storyline. Yeah, he does. He's
erotic, special. We'll just summarize that.
No, we can say it. We can call it erotic LitRPG fiction. I think that's appropriate. And a lot of it's published. And so he put it out there for that audience, which is totally cool. But it also kind of cross sections LitRPG. So if you're a fan of both, I mean, that's definitely the writer you want to go to.
Yeah. So I helped create a bunch of evolution charts. And I personally enjoyed working on monsters and how they would evolve, get stronger, different aspects. By the way, my character, Dr. Falcon, is in that particular story. Dr. Falcon is in a couple of Royal Road related stories. Dive is one, I think. I'm not sure if it's still there. Anyway, so evolutions and dungeons, I put them together and I said, well, what is something I can play around with that nobody else uses as a monster and that I can do whatever the heck I want with it for evolutions? Then the answer was slimes. Then Japanese slimes, everybody thinks of Dragon Quest. American slimes, nobody really thinks about it. But in D&D, they're like monsters you don't mess with. They kill everything. So I mixed a little of both.
Okay, perfect. And you made it your own, basically. So that's good. You answered that question plenty. I thank you very much. You kind of also unintentionally answered Justin Johansson's question, which was, will you ever return to Hero of the Night? Of the Knot?
The Knot?
The Hero of Knot?
Hero of Knot.
Okay. Hero of Knot. So it's not the. Okay. Yes. Sorry.
I have the 20 chapters of the first book rewrite done. So it's pretty close to completion already. Finish writing that, rewrite some of the early parts now that I have more writing experience, and put it on Amazon and should be good to go before the summer. I do not have a date at all for it at this point.
Okay, so this is more of a long-term project then for you.
Right, but I do plan on working on it once book three is out.
Okay. That's perfectly fair. Solid answer, Justin Johansson. You have your answer, my friend. Okay, now I have a couple questions. Just as a reader, less as like an interviewer. What new slimes can we expect to see in book three?
Ooh. Well, I'm going to give you some fun stuff. We have the introduction of tier 3 slimes in book 3 as part of his evolution. Tier 3 slimes are different because he can't make the slimes evolve past tier 2.
Right, because he has to evolve first, right? And then he can evolve his monsters.
Right. With tier 3 and above monsters, for slimes specifically, they have to eat something that triggers the evolution now.
Oh.
So before he could say, I can force this slime to evolve, and herb slime will become a jungle slime.
Right.
Well, now beyond the jungle slime, it's got to eat something specifically. And I'm not going to tell you that, but I will tell you one. The mimic slimes have eaten a lot of shed warg fur. And they have since become furry slimes.
That sounds interesting. That even sounds like it can go into to Scott's erotic stuff as a furry kind of title for a slime category. You might want to let him use that one too.
Not that kind of furry. We're gonna leave that to something else. When I say furry, I mean a glob of fur that moves without bones, so it's hideous to look at.
It's okay.
Plus, it has the fun ability to open its mouth and create slime hardened teeth about the size of a dagger.
Okay. That is a very unique combination of characteristics, I have to say. So the fact that they have to eat something to evolve in a specific path opens up a lot of opportunities as far as like variation of monster type and specialization. But it also creates a very limited scope depending upon what he's able to get them. Because right now, as far as book two goes, he's a static location, right? And so there are a limited number of natural resources that he can grab unless somebody's helping him get like rare resources, I think.
Right. If he wants to get more resources, he'll have to get stronger to attract stronger adventurers and also create better loot to attract better craftsmen who can create things. Like his poison slime was created when a herb slime, I think, I don't remember off the top of my head now, had some poison dipped on it. Now, what is that poison slime going to evolve into, I wonder?
Right.
Well, what if he gets exposed to an air type of poison? Or maybe it eats some paralysis grass or something. Mm-hmm. All sorts of things can happen.
Yeah, there are definitely a lot of possibilities. But that's an interesting combination of opening up possibilities, but also kind of nearing your opportunities as a storyteller, because you have to grab things. That's an interesting challenge. I don't envy you the challenge, to be honest, like creating all these different types.
I've got over 150 slimes created so far. I've got plenty more ideas.
Okay, great for you. I don't know that I could create that many different variations personally. So that's a skill that you have that I don't, my friend. Okay, so next question is for me. Is there going to be, in book one and book two, I don't mind if I spoil it, there are dungeons on dungeon battles. The first one is an infernal dungeon, I believe. I call it a demon dungeon in my head. I think book two has an undead dungeon, which is one of the ways that you show that dungeons can move around and transport. Was it that with a bone dungeon? Is there going to be another dungeon on dungeon battle in book three?
There wasn't a dungeon battle in book one. That was just a normal demon invasion.
Well, okay. Go ahead.
Book three, there will not be any dungeon on dungeon action. Mm-hmm. Book four, there will not be any dungeon on dungeon action. Those two are specially reserved for a different kind of fighting. I will leave that to your imagination.
Okay, that's fine.
Will likely be some.
Okay, that's perfectly fair. I mean, remember, you can always say I decline to answer that question. If it gets a little too spoilery, that's totally cool. Okay, here's my last, my last question is, how is book three going to differ from book one and two?
Book one was mostly about the dungeon. Book two was mostly about the dungeon's town, hence the name. Book three is going to have Doc working on his dungeon, but more in the case he is understanding the consequences of his actions. With book two, he allowed a crazy old man inside and worked out a deal to let some adventures go through without really knowing what was going to happen. Book three, he's going to feel more threatened for his life, so he's going to make some more decisions selfish decisions to work toward actually being a dungeon. You're going to see a lot more of him with upgrades, with fighting. Anodyne is going to be playing her first dungeon boss role, and he will be able to direct her, sort of like a puppet. You'll be entertained, I promise you that. Okay. So more proper dungeon fights from his perspective, for instance. The dungeon town, there is the conflicts that have been started in book one, continue to book two, are going to come to a conclusion in book three and book four.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much for those answers. You've answered a heck of a lot more than I thought you would, to be honest. I thought you'd be like, it's going to be named book three. That's different, right? So you got into a lot more detail than I thought you would. So thank you very much for that insight into what's upcoming in book three, which will be out, and again, in February, definitely. Might be towards the end or the middle. We'll have to wait and see. The writing process is not always linear. But also your Audible book will be coming up for book one. Again, end of February, beginning of March, as your narrator finishes work on recording and editing. Then Audible will take a couple weeks to do their processing work. So that'll be towards the end of February, beginning of March again. So thank you very much for answering all my questions. Was there anything else you wanted to talk about before we wrap up the show?
Dakota and I, he's the author of Divine Dungeon. Mm-hmm. We did talk about writing a co-op dungeon story back in the late fall. Mm-hmm. I haven't heard from him at all lately, so I don't know if he's still up for that. But that may or may not be coming at some point in time with his dungeon versus my dungeon.
Now, is this just going to be like a free, like non-canon fictional story of like your two dungeons like meeting somewhere and going head to head? Or is this going to be like canon, like your dungeons happen to exist in the same world?
It is going to be canon for my story, at least.
Okay.
Just because I have the perfect slime that results from this encounter. I created it before the idea was presented. Looking at it now, it's perfect from meeting him. I'm not sure about him. And mine was going to be planned for Halloween night. That's when the idea was created.
Okay.
Mischief and dimensional barriers fluctuate on Halloween night. You know, that general fantasy idea.
Yeah, the veil between the worlds gets thin on All Hallows Eve. Yep. I can see how that works. That's really cool, actually. As a fan of both series, I would love to see your dungeons go head-to-head and see what happens, even if it's just like an online extra story, like a what-if kind of thing that doesn't really impact the main story as canon. I would still like to read that. So I encourage Dakota, if he's listening, to get a hold of you.
Yeah, I think he needs to finish his book first, and then maybe he'll get back in touch with me. We'll see.
Yeah, he's definitely working on a very similar release schedule that you are for his second book in the series. I believe he plans to come out with a February release date as well, tentatively, again, as writing sometimes takes word twists. So thank you very much for talking to me and listening, talking to our audience and listening to my questions and taking those audience questions. It was really cool, you man. I appreciate that. Where can folks find where to find your works, man? If they want to know about your stories, or especially those online ones, where can they find you?
That would be Royal Road for the most part. I have immense loyalty to Royal Road, which you may or may not have noticed by now. I have 6 stories on there. Hero of Knot and Slime Dungeon are the 2 big ones that have completed books. Valgrim is there. That was my first story. Not so well written, but it's entertaining in the very least. If you imagine a D&D game where you mess up the DM's story so badly, he wants to flip the table.
Based on a true story, by the way.
Yeah, based on a true story of a fake story. Yonder is my take on reincarnation as an animal. There's a couple of stories, chapters on that. It's meant to be cute. Mm-hmm. Respite of a Fallen World is my apocalypse story. It starts off, of course, with zombies. I rewrote that for the first 7 chapters. I still don't like it. I might rewrite it again. And
yeah, that happens. Yeah.
Shoot, was there one more? What was one more?
Now, just for folks who know, what your author name on the World Road is not Jeffrey. What's your World Gnome Road name?
Falcon 167. On most electronic profiles of anything you'll find, it will be Falcon 167 or a variety of number variants of that. That okay. is my username for most things. I just couldn't get it as an author name for legal reasons.
Okay, so there you go. That should be your, it would be weird to say written by a Falcon. I don't know that, Amazon would be cool with that. I used R.A. Mejia. I think they were cool with that, but whatever. Okay, thank you very much. You're also on the railroad. You have an Amazon page. We'll have links in the show notes too. We'll have all the book links to your stuff from Amazon and the railroad on the show notes to the podcast. So guys, look for that in the show notes if you're interested in finding out more about Falcon's writing. And of course, he has a Goodreads page, which every author, whether they want it or not, has on there as well. So thank you very much again for talking to me, for talking to our viewers and answering all my questions. We've been talking for hours and hours, literally. So we'll end the podcast here and just say thank you very much. If you want to say goodbye to everybody real quick.
Stay classy.
There you go. And for the Lit RPG podcast, I am Ramon Mejia, folks. And remember, until we meet again, go read some Lit RPG.